The diversity of dinosaurs is one of evolution's greatest success stories, branching into various bloodlines and expanding across the world. Few were as successful as the hadrosaurs, the dazzling duckbills of the Cretaceous period, a group famous for their duck-billed faces, batteries of teeth, being found all across the world, and having the most intriguing variety of head ornaments. One of, if not the most iconic of the hadrosaurs, truly embodies the success and bizarreness of the group, with its signature silhouette and its characteristic tuba-shaped crest. This hadrosaur has stuck in the minds of scientists and the general public. The hadrosaur whose songs echoed throughout the Cretaceous landscapes. The Parasaurolophus. Parasaurolophus was a large hadrosaur from what is now North America, and by far one of, if not the most interesting of the group. This docile plant eater lived during the Cretaceous period, approximately 75 to 73 million years ago during the Campanian stage. Parasaurolophus was a fairly large animal, with different species reaching length estimates measuring at 9 meters or 30 feet, with weight estimates of 2 to 3 tons, with its tremendous weight carried by long, thick legs with robust thigh bones, shoulders, and hip bones. In addition, these animals, like all hadrosaurs, could switch gaits during locomotion, likely spending time on all fours for walking and foraging, and switching onto two legs when browsing, looking around, or running. Complementing its large body size was its 5-foot skull, standing out with a long tubular crest sprouting from the top of its head, a structure that has made this animal incredibly recognizable to the average person. The crest itself is part of where this dinosaur got its name from, Parasaurolophus, meaning near-crested lizard. Not only for the presence of the crest, but in the vein of another crested hadrosaur called Saurolophus, which was originally thought to be closely related to Parasaurolophus. However, despite their names, we've come to learn that these animals are actually quite distantly related, belonging to two subfamilies, with Saurolophus belonging to Saurolophinae, a group of derived hadrosaurs characterized by their wide duck bills, extremely large size, and little to no presence of crests on their heads. Parasaurolophus, on the other hand, was a member of the Lambeosaurine hadrosaurs, a subfamily of duck-billed dinosaurs known for their dazzling, exotic crests, coming in all manner of shapes and sizes. The classic crest of Parasaurolophus epitomizes this intriguing trait, and has made it not only the most famous Lambeosaur, but one of the most iconic dinosaurs of all time. The function of the iconic crest of Parasaurolophus has been the source of many, many questions for paleontologists ever since its discovery. What was this crest? What was it used for? Why did Parasaurolophus have such an intriguing adaptation? Fortunately, for nearly a century since its discovery, we've learned a great deal since about this animal, and have pieced together much of the mysterious puzzle of this great tuba head. Calling Parasaurolophus a tuba head isn't just a nickname based on superficial resemblance to a tuba or a trombone, although the largest accepted species, Parasaurolophus tubescens, is named after a trumpet. And for good reason. For many years, a great many proposals were presented to help explain this extravagant feature. It was initially thought to be a snorkel, or a trunk, or a weapon, or just a method of smelling better. However, these hypotheses didn't hold up to scrutiny. The true nature of this crest, however, laid inside it. When scientists looked inside the skulls of these animals, there was a puzzling set of complex nasal passages and structures running from the crest to the nose. As a result, it raised more questions regarding the use of these crests. A study performed in the 1990s revealed an interesting adaptation. These structures allowed Parasaurolophus to produce a wide range of low-frequency sounds. Once more, Lambeosaurine hadrosaurs like Parasaurolophus had various adaptations in their ears indicating a great importance of hearing in these animals, and the combination of these factors presented the most compelling and best-supported theory to this day: communication. Through the use of a 3D model based on a well-preserved Parasaurolophus skull, scientists were able to recreate what sounds this animal could produce. And for the first time in over 70 million years, Parasaurolophus would call once more. The wide range of bellows, honks, and toots likely played a vital role in communication, allowing the parasaurs to call to each other over long distances while communicating different signals to individuals while being social. While the social habits of Parasaurolophus remain relatively unknown, the development of these complex vocal structures are a strong indicator of social interactions, be it herding behavior or social gatherings, or even just communicating over long distances. We can, however, look to other hadrosaurs for reference, many of which display social habits including herding and group nesting. We can also look to modern animals to help support this hypothesis, with complex vocal communication being found typically on animals with some social structure, including elephants, frogs, crocodilians, birds, canines, felines, cetaceans, and primates, all of which use a wide range of sounds to communicate, and have various special adaptations relating to sound, be it over long distances, among social gatherings, or both. Based on this occurrence, we can infer a strong possibility of Parasaurolophus sharing this trait of being social, with each species using a wide range of sounds to communicate. Such extreme traits, however, are rarely to never serve a singular purpose, often performing multiple jobs in favor of the animal. The extremity of the crest's development is likely an indicator of a different type of communication. Instead of sound, this was made for visual display as well, with crests advertising age, individuality, health, and desirability as mates. It was once thought that there was a fleshy flap of skin that lay behind the crest, with many pieces of art reconstructing parasaurs with this flap based on a notch found on certain specimens. However, this has been interpreted as possible pathology, or in layman's terms, signs of injury or sickness, rather than evidence of a fleshy flap. That doesn't mean there wasn't a fleshy flap, but for the moment, it's more of a speculative look. What's less speculative is how parasaurs looked on the outside. We actually have skin impressions of this animal, with the skin impression showing uniform tubercle-like scales, but otherwise no larger structures. But at the very least, we can get an idea of what this animal looked like on the outside. Another interesting aspect of the crest itself is its composition and how different it is from other lambeosaurine hadrosaurs. Most lambeosaur crests are composed of the premaxilla, the formation of bone on the upper jaw, and the nasal bone pretty evenly. Parasaurolophus is an exception, with the crest being 98% premaxilla, with the rest being nasal bones and structures. The structure and complexity of the crest varied among different species of Parasaurolophus, with Parasaurolophus tubescens having the largest crest and the most complex inner workings. Parasaurolophus walkeri had the least complex of the accepted species, but also the most moderate crest. And Parasaurolophus cerdocristatus, sharing a similar complexity to tubescens, but having an incredibly short curved crest. The case of Parasaurolophus cerdocristatus is a curious one. It has been speculated that the small crest of cerdocristatus was due to sexual dimorphism, or the variation of appearance based on differing sex, instead of the result of speciation, or the split of species in the family tree in layman's terms. What's more, Parasaurolophus cerdocristatus shares many similarities with what few remains we have of Parasaurolophus tubescens, leading some to believe that cerdocristatus was a female version of tubescens. However, many studies have denoted this hypothesis, noting that the time, location, and age, and anatomy indicate that these species are separate. What's more interesting than the variation of the crests, though, is the growth of these crests, and the overall development and growth of Parasaurolophus. In 2009, a very special Parasaurolophus was discovered, the youngest Parasaurolophus ever found. Nicknamed Joe by those that discovered it, Joe is a very important discovery because of what it reveals about Parasaurolophus' development from such an early age. Based on the findings, it's clear that even from an early age, Parasaurolophus was already bearing a crest. However, it wasn't as elongated and tubular as the adults, instead being a small nub on the forehead that would one day grow into the elongated, characteristic head ornament that we know and love. The location of the developing crest is especially noteworthy, showing the crests weren't just sprouting from the back of the head as they appear in the adults, but instead, pterosaurs gradually grew their crests from the small nubs running from their nasal cavities that would eventually grow on the top of their heads as they grew older. What's more, the remains also present another key find. These animals were developing their crests faster than most Lambeosaurines. When compared to its relatives like Corythosaurus, Parasaurolophus was growing its crest sooner than those it was related to, with juveniles already sporting signs of a crest by the time they were a quarter of their parent's size, unlike other Lambeosaurs who began growing their crests at half their adult size. What's more, it also suggests a faster growth rate, with these animals growing and developing into adulthood faster than their relatives. Such a fast growth rate also indicates the type of environment that these animals were living in. Parasaurolophus was quite the widespread dinosaur, despite being incredibly rare in the fossil record, being found as far north as Canada all the way down to New Mexico, with varying species based on the time and region. Parasaurolophus walkeri, the type species for the genus, is known from Canada in what is now known as the Dinosaur Park Formation. During that time, the Dinosaur Park Formation was a temperate floodplain, with forests of conifers and angiosperms littered throughout, with this ecosystem being host to a wide range of diverse dinosaurs, including various types of hadrosaurs like Corythosaurus, a crested lambeosaur like Parasaurolophus, but instead of a tuba-like crest, it had a large bony comb sitting on the top of its head. Other dinosaurs that lived in the area during this time included the armored ankylosaurs, like Euoplocephalus, adorned with armored plates, spiked shoulders, and its tail ending in a club. And then there were the ceratopsids, like chasmosaurs and centrosaurs, with their dazzling arrays of frills, horns, and spikes, and a diverse range of theropods, from ornithomimosaurs to troodonts to dromaeosaurs, the most terrifying of tyrannosaurs like Gorgosaurus and Despletosaurus. Parasaurolophus is uncommon in the area, however, and was likely a seasonal migrant rather than a resident of the north. However, as the western interior sea creeped northward, conditions seemed less favorable for Parasaurolophus, and ultimately, Parasaurolophus began moving southward to what is now the western United States, being more common in the southwest in particular. As they moved southward, they began to grow closer to the shores of the western interior seaway, alongside a host of new, yet familiar creatures, many of which being southern counterparts of their relatives of the north, with ceratopsids like the bull-horned Nasutoceratops, and the big-nosed hadrosaur Gryposaurus, and of course, the terrifying tyrannosaurs of the south, Teratophonius and Bistavenator. What's interesting is that the range of Parasaurolophus may not have been limited to North America, but may have even extended to late Cretaceous Asia. A distant larger relative called Coronosaurus lived in what is now China, with some raising the possibility that it may be a species of Parasaurolophus. However, due to limited remains, anatomical differences, and age, it is very unlikely, and at this time, remains its own distinct genus. As dazzling and diverse as this hadrosaur was, it would eventually meet its end at the hands of extinction. There was a change in the wind, or rather, in the sea. As the western interior seaway began to shrink, the climate began to change, and many animals couldn't keep up with the change, Parasaurolophus being among them, disappearing from the fossil record 73 million years ago. However, the calls of Parasaurolophus continue to echo today, not only through the reconstruction of its sounds, but through its critical presence in media. Parasaurolophus is by far one of the most famous dinosaurs ever known, thanks to its unusual crest, and has sparked the intrigue and imagination of people for almost 100 years, making numerous appearances in television, film, video games, and literature, be it direct appearance or through inspiration. One of its most stunning appearances was in the year 2000, with Disney's Dinosaur,
with the young Parasaurolophus taking center stage in the film's iconic opening sequence. This film has one of the greatest depictions of Parasaurolophus ever put to screen,
presenting not only one of the most accurate reconstructions to date, save for the crest flap, but ultimately standing above the rest with its eerie, unforgettable calls. Ultimately, Parasaurolophus is one of the most mysterious and fascinating dinosaurs ever known, and will continue to haunt our imaginations with its signature headdress and the trumpeting of crested hadrosaurs.